First, I agree. Second, I think it's part of a generalized problem of corporate governance. It's not unique to banks. There's a generalized problem of corporate governance in particularly Anglo-Saxon shareholder, I've just focused on that, shareholder-driven companies. But I think it tends to be, in my view, this is a British perspective, and I don't want to push this too far because our banks have been pretty sensationally incompetent too. I won't go into the reasons for that. But it is very common in the United States for, as I see it, for the chairman and CEO role to be combined in one, which is contrary to our standards completely. We would always insist on a separation of these two roles, and for the board essentially to be appointed by these people. So the board is an echo for they've been selected precisely because they aren't a problem. If you have a very complicated business, which is very non-transparent and in addition has the benefit of very large implicit public guarantees, implicit or even explicit, and you have essentially a dictatorship, this is what I'm describing, you're going to depend entirely on the probity, good sense, self-discipline of one person. Well, I have a view on relying on that. It's not a very good governance structure. It's why, you know, politically we have democracy. So I think that the corporate governance we've allowed to evolve, not just in banking, but more broadly, is extremely defective. This has been reinforced in the US by excessive reduction, actually, in the effectiveness of shareholders in a number of ways. So I support what you say, but I would go much further. I think there's a profound dysfunction in boards across, it certainly applies to Britain and America, but I think it's actually, in the respects I've discussed, worse here.
Question. Please identify yourself.
I'm Nick Schwartz with BGIA, and I was wondering, obviously one of the big problems right now is China's excess savings clout, and what do you think that they could do to spur, basically, to get rid of those excess savings, whether by domestic consumption or spurring demand amongst its populace or investment in any way? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, okay, that's quite a big question. First of all, for those of you who are not familiar with the numbers for China, they are... and the numbers for China aren't certain because national income data for China are not certain. But broadly speaking, this is the picture for China. The savings rate, gross national savings rate for China is 60% of GDP. I repeat, 60% of GDP. And consumption is 40%. The domestic investment is about 50% of GDP. There are some problems with these data. You may have to knock off 5 percentage points or so. It's 50% of GDP, and the current account surplus is roughly 10. So that's how the savings are disposed. 5/6 is at home and 1/6 is abroad. Consumption is therefore obviously 40% of GDP. Of that, roughly speaking, 10 percentage points is public, and the rest is household. So household consumption is 30% of GDP, roughly speaking. But household disposable income is not much more than 40% of GDP. These are all quite extraordinary numbers. I mean, this is so outside the normal structure of an economy that it's very difficult to answer this question easily. So what this means is, I won't go into the question of how it got to be like this, because it's fascinating and very complicated, and I think a lot of it we don't understand. But this means that raising consumption, so it's a really big chunk of GDP, out of household consumption, means they have to stop saving altogether. And households in China are not going to stop saving altogether. It's just not relevant. Okay? So all the stuff these folks, all this discussion read on safety nets, you constantly get this. It's absolutely irrelevant to this problem. It's very relevant to the future of Chinese welfare. It's something that should be done, but it won't solve this problem. They're saving about a third of disposable income, and that's probably what the Chinese are going to go on doing, just as the Indians are doing, a little less than a third of their disposable income. Two-thirds of the savings in China come from the corporate sector and the government, not from the household sector, and that's the problem. And the problem is a complete breakdown of corporate governance again, because the savings of the corporate sector don't belong to anybody. Now, mostly government. So the answer in the short run is you extract resources from the corporate sector through dividends and taxation. That goes to the government. The government spends. The government spends on public consumption and transferring income directly to the household sector. That's the core of it. Very easy. China has a proper government. It can run things, unlike most comparable emerging countries, if they decide to send money to every Chinese citizen, it would get there, if they really wanted to. And that's how, in my view, it starts. Then they can start spending it. They can also spend on the health system, which has collapsed in the rural areas, the education system, and so forth. That, a lot of that is part of what they're doing. Unfortunately, a lot of what they're now doing is not that. It's just even more cement and concrete and steel. They've got a capacity to produce 600 million tons of steel a year, I understand. Well, you have to build an awful lot of roads and other things to use all that stuff. So the problem is what they're going to do to increase spending in the short run will not add to jobs, it will not add to welfare, but it will all certainly add to the flow of concrete across China. The longer-term changes are, I've described, the medium-term changes are what I've described, a change in the getting the income to the household. 40% of GDP disposable income is ridiculous. It's just ridiculous. That means the vast bulk of the Chinese people aren't receiving the income flow of the country. And of course that explains why consumption is so low. It's completely different in China. And in the longer run, they've got to attach ownership to households, and they've got to get away from what has become only in this decade, it wasn't true previously, a very capital-intensive line of development which isn't generating employment. Contrary to what many people think, everybody says they've got to keep exports going to generate employment. The manufacturing sector is not generating jobs in China. And the reason they're not generating employment is the service sector doesn't grow, which is where jobs normally come from, as the Indians have shown. And that won't grow without consumption. And that won't grow as long as disposable income is 40% of GDP. So basically, very simply, China has to be restructured. And for a 1.3 billion people population country, so it's not going to happen except under crisis. And the good thing about what's happening, and the only good thing about what's happening, is the crisis is now here. And the Chinese government knows, because they really do understand. I've spoken to them, seen the Prime Minister recently in the World Economic Forum. They know they have to change the structure. And that is promising, because unlike the Germans and the Japanese, knowing that, I think they will do it.
I think we have to call a halt to it there. But just to follow up on the point and on your question, somebody explained once about, tried to explain the complexities of China and all the figures, the details, which Martin, I'm sure, masters much better than the rest of us. Look at it this way. Any number you choose multiplied by 1.3 billion is a big number. And I think coming back to this point, quite aside from the financial crisis, the economic recessions, which is now global and shows how we're all interconnected, it's going to be this relationship in so many levels, political, social, cultural, economic, and financial, between the United States and China, or the Western world and China, that's going to be really determinant. It has been said, and I've said it, and some of you have heard this many times, that up until quite recently, the most important alliance in the world, arguably, was between the People's Republic of China and the Consumers' Republic of Walmart, export and consumption. Well, that world may be breaking down, that alliance may be weakening severely, and we don't know what's going to take its place. We hope and trust it's not going to be the end of the world, but it is the end of our session this evening. I want to thank Martin again for being here, and we'll take you up on your invitation to come back annually. And Carter, too, do you want to say a word? Because thank you very much for everything you have done to make this possible. Thank you, and above all, thanks to all of you. Good night.